Good morning, everybody. Welcome back. Today we'll talk about very important topic in those working ICU. I will talk about transcranial doppler in daily ICU practice. I will talk about my experience about transcranial doppler over the previous years in the ICU. What is the TCD? TCD, if you see this picture of the VTI of the left ventricular flow tract, TCD is the study of the blood flow. This is the blood flow coming from the left ventricular flow tract. TCD is the study of the blood flow going through the cerebral vessels. This is a blood flow. It is simply a study of the flow pattern of the basal cerebral vessels. Main vessels, middle cerebral artery, anterior cerebral artery, posterior, vertebral, basilar. There are two types of transcranial doppler: conventional transcranial doppler and the transcranial color-coded duplex. Conventional transcranial doppler is mainly a spectral doppler, but today we'll talk about transcranial color-coded duplex. It is really a real study and the full study of the blood flow through the cranial vessel, basal vessels. It's better than conventional TCD examination because it shows the images of intracranial anatomy and arteries by duplex beam while still having the capacity to measure velocity with the Doppler. So it is a real study. It is color flow, it is a Doppler study, it is the M mode, it is real flow as you will see. As you know about any ultrasound study, it is non-invasive, inexpensive, repeatable, bedside, sensitive, specific way to examine the basal cerebral arteries. The main limitation for TCD for transcranial color-coded, really the main obstacle is in some people, especially elderly female, about 10%, you will not get the temporal window, which is the common window we use to get the transcranial doppler, because there is very difficult to get a window and the bone is very heavily calcified. The bone in this area and you cannot go through, so you will not insulate the cerebral artery. This is the main obstacle really for the transcranial doppler. It occurs in 10% of patients. How to do it? I have in my channel several videos about how to do transcranial doppler through the temporal window. But today, in brief, I need to give you a very important trick to do the transcranial doppler through the temporal window. Very important trick. Let us see. First, the position of the probe. You will put the probe in front of the tragus, from 1 to 5 centimeters in front of the tragus, and you will put in the probe with an angle of 30 degrees with the horizon. It's very important. The patient can lie on one side, or you can just turn the head on the one side and put the probe. You will put here in front of the tragus about 30 degrees from the horizon. Okay? Look for this beauty image of CT reconstruction image. Here you will put the probe. Here is the temporal approach in front of the tragus. Here is anterior, here is posterior. And as you see, the probe, the ultrasound beam, will get the middle cerebral artery in good angle here. And if you tilt the probe downward, you will get the posterior cerebral artery in the lower level here. So the most important thing is putting the phase array probe in front of the tragus in the temporal approach with 30 degrees with the horizon, and the most important movement of the probe is the tilting, downward tilting, downward and upward tilting, to get this middle cerebral artery and anterior cerebral artery or middle cerebral artery, and downward tilting to get this posterior cerebral artery. And you can in some patient do rotation, slight rotation, but this is the most important type of movement. Let us see. Here is the probe in front of the tragus. This is the posterior, this is the anterior. And you can make 30 degree with the horizon and tilting downward, upward, tilting. You can make some rotation in some people, but most movement is the tilting. Here, this is the what when you will put the phase array probe here in the temporal area, you are looking for two things really. The first, you will look for this butterfly. If you put the probe here, here is the anterior, here is the posterior, here is the beam, the ultrasound beam going in this direction. So we'll get the arteries inside here in the middle of the brain. You will search for this butterfly area, which is the region of the brain stem. And through around this butterfly area, you will get all the major vessels of the brain. This is the posterior cerebral artery curving around the brain stem. And in front here and in the upper level, you will get the middle cerebral artery going from medially to laterally. And in this direction, you will get the anterior cerebral artery. To clarify more, this is the first. If you didn't see the butterfly area, please look for this hyperechoic bone ridge, which is the lesser sphenoid wing. It's very important. Here is the posterior, here is the right side, here is the posterior, here is the anterior, and here is the lateral, here is the medial, okay? And as you see here, you will look for this hyperechoic curve. Here is the lesser sphenoid ridge, and you will see all the middle cerebral artery coming from medially to laterally, lateral to this ridge, and in the opposite direction, you will see the anterior cerebral artery going from lateral to medial around this lesser sphenoid ridge. This is very important landmark. Here is the lesser sphenoid ridge, lesser sphenoid wing, and here is the ultrasound picture of lesser sphenoid ring. Here is the CT picture of the lesser sphenoid wing. Moreover, you see here in the patient, this is a CT angio, and this is the transcranial color coded. You will see here butterfly and the posterior cerebral artery curving around the midbrain, and here is the brain, posterior cerebral artery curving around the midbrain, and you will see here middle cerebral artery, and you will see here middle cerebral artery. This is the left side. Okay. What are you going to look? Now you put the phase array probe in front of the tragus in the temporal region with a 30 degree with the horizon, and you make a good tilting downward and some rotation in some people, and you get the cerebral vessel. What are you looking for? Simply, you need to know the basic of the Doppler study, which is spectral Doppler and the color flow Doppler. The basic of the Doppler rule is any blood flow towards the probe will give you red color. And any blood flow towards the probe, you will give you positive wave in above the baseline in the spectral wave. This is the basic of the Doppler study. You need to know the difference between the vital organ and non-vital organ as regard blood flow. As you see here, this is the blood flow in the cerebral, in the middle cerebral artery, in the brain. As you see here, all the blood flow above the baseline, the brain receives blood in systole and in diastole. In both phases of cardiac cycle, the brain should receive blood because it's a vital organ. As you see here, the diastolic flow, almost 50% of systolic flow. But in non-vital organ, this is the systolic flow, but in the diastole, there is reverser of the blood flow in the diastole here, and this is a triphasic wave of the lower limb because it's non-vital organ. The lower limb don't need to receive blood through all the cardiac cycle. It receives in systole and in part of the diastole. Okay, this is very important. Now, what are you going to look for after you do the study of transcranial Doppler? Number one, you need to look for the diastolic flow. First, when you get the transcranial Doppler of any cranial vessels, first thing to look for is the alteration of the diastolic flow in the transcranial Doppler. If you find loss of the diastolic flow or reverse flow, you will think about marked increase of intracranial pressures in circulatory arrest of the brain stem. Let us see. This is the transcranial Doppler in patient with brain death. As you see here, there is systolic flow, but there is loss of the diastolic flow. And here you will see the reversal of the diastolic flow. What does it mean? This means that during the diastole, during the diastolic period, there is no flow to the brain, which is not accepted in vital organ. And this is because increased intracranial pressure inside the brain, which is interfering with the blood flow during the diastole. And this is very bad signs and denoting severe increase in intracranial pressure. You see here, this should be the diastolic flow, but here is reverse flow in the brain death. So, first thing, you will look for the diastolic flow in the transcranial Doppler. Second, you will look for the systolic upstroke. Systolic upstroke normally should be sharp upstroke, should go very quickly to the peak, very steep curve. But if you see the systolic upstroke going slowly to the peak with this dull appearance, dull slow rise like here, that means there is proximal obstruction if happen in one vessels, but if it happen all over the vessels, that means systemic hypoperfusion and generalized hypoperfusion. Third, you will look for the flow velocity of the cerebral vessels. And for each intracranial artery, there is a specific and there is normal velocity. If this velocity increased, it could be either stenosis, spasm, or could be hyperdynamic circulation. And we'll know how to differentiate between both later in the lectures about talking about the disease. This is a normal flow here of the middle cerebral artery, and this is increased flow velocity of the middle cerebral artery here, because normally middle cerebral artery velocity is maximum 120 centimeters per second. Now it is 170 in this patient. Third, is fourth, you look for diastolic appearance, diastolic flow appearance, the systolic upstroke, the flow velocity, and the force, you will look for the BI, which is pulsatility index. And this is very easy. The machine will calculate it for you. You will only put the sample volume pulsed wave Doppler in the artery, and you will fire the machine. It will get this beauty curve, and you can put one mark in the peak systolic velocity and the other mark in the end of the systolic velocity, and the machine will give you pulsatility index, which is peak systolic velocity minus end of the systolic velocity over the mean velocity, and it will give you in very clear way in the machine here. This pulsatility index, normally not more than one. If more than one, there will be a problem, and we'll see here pulsatility index has very important application in ICU setting. It will give us a very important clue about the prognosis of head trauma, mild to moderate head trauma. If more than 1.25, it will give a bad prognosis. And second, the pulsatility index will increase in the cerebrovascular risk increase if, and second, and second, pulsatility index will increase in case of increased cerebral vascular resistance, like all small vessel disease of the brain, as long as cerebral perfusion pressure is stable. And we'll see later the application of this BI. Talk about now, you know how to do transcranial Doppler, and what are you going to look for? Now let us see how transcranial Doppler help us in ICU daily practice. Case one, a 17 years old male patient admitted to RCU because of sudden onset of left side hemiplegia. We did echo for the patient. It revealed mass in the mitral valve area here. Could be myxoma, could be vegetation. But what about transcranial Doppler? I need to know the flow in the left, the right middle cerebral artery, because I have left side hemiplegia. Here is the right side of the patient. I put the phasor ray probe here. Here is the posterior, here is the anterior. This is the right side. Here is the brain stem, butterfly appearance. Here is the posterior cerebral artery. Here is the anterior, here is the middle cerebral artery, and this is the lesser sphenoid wing. As you see here, I didn't see any middle cerebral artery flow along the lesser sphenoid wing. So there is complete obstruction here of the middle cerebral artery of the right side, and there is increased flow of the counterpart middle cerebral artery on the left side. Here, increased flow. It's away from the probe, so it is in blue. So complete obstruction. What's the gold standard to confirm that? It is the cerebral angio, as you see here, complete obstruction of the middle right side middle cerebral artery appear here, as we see, and it's very clear to see in the transcranial Doppler also. Next day, remember, transcranial Doppler is repeatable. You can, it's a bit sign, quick, you can know what's going on. This is the next day, start some flow here in the right side, some flow, but still very bad flow in the right middle cerebral artery. But as you see here, increased flow all over the other vessels. Next day, you see here, flow start to appear in the right side middle cerebral artery, start recanalization start to appear. So in this patient, transcranial Doppler help us in diagnosing in the complete obstruction of the right side middle cerebral artery and in follow up about recanalizations. As you see here, gradually the flow increase, and we can through the pulsed wave Doppler know the character of the flow and the degree of the flow and the magnitude of the flow. As you see here, this was the second day and this was the third day. It became now almost normal flow. Complete recanalization happened. And this is very important use of transcranial Doppler in stroke, which by the way of thrombolysis in brain ischemia, TB thrombolysis in brain ischemia, you can see exactly the magnitude of recanalization and the magnitude of the cerebral blood flow in follow-up the patient with a stroke. As you see here, with this flow you can grade it 5-3, and this flow can grade it normal 5. It's 5 grades, and gradually, according to the magnitude of the flow, you will get the grade of the flow. TCD is very important in management and the prognosis of cerebral vascular stroke by properly confirming recanalization with very good accuracy. Case 2. A 63 years old male patient, known case of long-standing hypertension, diabetes mellitus, complained of right side hemiplegia. Another stroke in old patient here. You see, hypertrophic heart, heart of hypertensive, and ballooning of left atrium of the systolic dysfunction, but no thrombus inside. This is the left side carotid, internal carotid. You see here plaques in both sides of the carotid, internal carotid, denoting atherosclerosis. You see here there is stenosis because of this atherosclerosis at the plaques, calcified plaques, as you see here. Here is the middle cerebral artery of the patient on the left side. As you see here, here is the anterior, here is the posterior, here is the dull, slow rise of systolic upstroke denoting a proximal obstruction. As you see here with transcranial Doppler, if you did CT, here left side, thrombus appear in the middle cerebral artery and evolving malignant left side middle cerebral stroke with CT. Cranial ultrasound is great in diagnosing vessel-to-vessel stroke, as you see in this patient. Case 3, a 17 years old male patient admitted to our ICU because of right cerebellar bleed, a small left epidural hemorrhage and subarachnoid hemorrhage due to head trauma. He was fully conscious, moving four limbs, hemodynamically stable, complained of severe headache. Neurosurgical team decided conservative management. Patient was improving on conservative management with follow-up CT brain, almost the same. As you see here, first CT, second CT. ICU managed, we used to do baseline cranial ultrasound for any neurocritical case admitted to our ICU, head trauma, stroke, subarachnoid hemorrhage. It's very important to get a baseline because this you will compare with this baseline later on. This is the baseline of the patient. This is the left middle cerebral artery. Here is the anterior. Here is the posterior. Here is the middle cerebral artery. As you see here, the velocity 77, BI 1.15. This is the right side anterior cerebral artery. Velocity 56. This is the basilar artery, velocity 69. Patient was managed conservatively by nimodipine, proper analgesia, proper fluid intake, and the mild sedation. During the ICU course, the patient became irritable and complained of severe headache. Repeat TCD, as you see here, the left middle cerebral artery, velocity from 77 increased to 170. And here, 196. It's increasing with follow-up. Good. What is the causes of increased velocity of the cranial vessels, intracranial vessels? Two causes, really. One is a vasospasm, and second is the hyperemic flow, as in case of hyperdynamic circulation like anemia, like fever, like hyperthyroidism. And how to differentiate between these causes? Very simply, hyperemia is a systemic phenomenon. It will affect the velocity all over the vessel, extracranial and intracranial. But spasm is local process, will affect only intracranial vessels. So we can do a formula here. If you see here, what's called Lindegaard equation is very important equation. Lindegaard equation, it will compare between the velocity in the intracranial vessels and the velocity in the extracranial vessels. So here we'll put mean flow velocity of the middle cerebral artery over the mean flow velocity of the same side internal carotid artery. If it's hyperemic flow, both will increase because it's systemic phenomena, and the Lindegaard equation will be normal. But if there is local spasm, you will get high mean flow velocity in the middle cerebral artery, but in the outside the brain intracranial artery, there will be no spasm and no stenosis, and Lindegaard equation will be high. In case of middle cerebral arteries in anterior circulation, this Lindegaard, if it's more than 3, it is mild to moderate vasospasm. If it's more than 6, it's severe vasospasm. As you see here, we did in severe anemia, we did a flow study here in the carotid arterial carotid artery and here in the middle cerebral artery. And as you see here, it's almost the same, 190, 145. So the ratio, it is almost, yeah, 1 plus. Very important, and it's very small. It's going with anemia, hyperemic flow. But in diagnosis of vasospasm, as you see here, the Lindegaard, if more than 3 in the middle cerebral artery, would be mild. If more than 6, would be severe. And absolute value for the flow velocity in the middle cerebral artery and other vessels is. Cutoff value for diagnosed vasospasm in intracranial arteries are middle cerebral artery, mean flow velocity more than 120 centimeters per second will be mild spasm, more than 130 centimeters per second moderate spasm, more than 200 is severe spasm. In the basilar artery, mean flow velocity above 60 mild, above 80 moderate, above 115 severe, and Lindegaard in the basilar artery more than 3, and we'll compare between the flow velocity of the basilar artery and the extracranial vertebral artery. For the vertebral artery, mean flow velocity more than 60 centimeters mild spasm, 80 centimeters moderate to severe spasm. Okay? Back to our patient. This is the mean flow velocity of our patient middle cerebral artery, and this is the same side internal carotid artery. As you see here, it is when we did the equation, mean flow velocity here and the mean flow velocity here, it was more than 3, and it was moderate spasm. Because here is the mean, you are talking about 19 plus, and you can calculate the mean here from the peak and in the diastole. And this is the basal artery of our patient. As you see here, with the spasm, it reached to 115 centimeter per second, absolute value, which is going with severe spasm, okay? The baseline was 69. Transcranial Doppler is reasonable to monitor for the development of arterial vasospasm. This is class 2A, level of evidence B, new recommendation for American Heart Association, American Stroke Association, 2012. Case 4. A 50-year-old female patient, known case of sickle cell disease. We have in Eastern province here in Saudi Arabia a lot of cases of sickle cell disease, really. This patient has sickle cell disease, admitted to our ICU because what's called systemic fat embolization syndrome, as evidenced by severe acute syndrome, shooting of liver enzymes, muscle enzymes, acute kidney injury, DIC, with mortal vein thrombosis. It's very common to see this systemic fat embolization in Eastern province. Here is the infiltrate of acute syndrome. Here is the flow velocity resistivity index of the right side of the renal arteries, segmental renal arteries. It's high, it's supposed to be 0.7, it is 0.77. As you see here, Bardo, in the kidney, this is vital organ. You see here the flow always above the baseline because the kidney receives flow during systole and diastole because it's vital organ. This high RI denoting acute kidney injury in the right side, and here also in the left side, high RI denoting acute kidney injury. Here is the portal vein thrombosis of the patient, the portal vein thrombosis. What about the brain? Really, this is a transcranial Doppler of the patient, left middle cerebral artery. It's okay. And mild increase of the velocity because of anemia. And you see here, pulsatility index less than one. It's okay. Patient was connected to mechanical ventilator, giving the supportive treatment of systemic fat embolization with antibiotic, steroid, IV fluids, massive exchange transfusion. She was improved from respiratory side with low setting of ventilation now. We stopped sedation, but patient didn't wake up in a proper time. So, patient improved as regard cardiopulmonary, but she didn't wake up after stopping sedation. What's going on? Repeat TCD. It is bedside, repeatable, very easy to follow your baseline of the patient. You see here, the pulsatility index increased from 0.88 to 1.42. There is significant increase of PI. What does it mean? It means a small vessel disease. If the cerebral perfusion pressure is stable, that means it is a small vessel disease. And we know systemic fat embolization can affect the small vessel of the brain. So there was a clear increase of pulsatility index compared to the baseline value. We know that systemic fat embolization is a small vessel disease. That means that there was an affection of the cerebral small vessels leading to increased downward resistance in cerebral circulation. We get this valuable information in a couple of minutes, and we can build up our management according to the piece of information now, non-invasively and very quickly. We did MRI. We find this hyper-intense area in diffusion image denoting ischemia, and this is the flare. There is multiple ischemia and multiple bleed, small bleed, and we did angio, normal grade vessels, so it is real small vessel disease of systemic fat embolization. This is the normal macro vessels, CT angio. TCD driven pulsatility index has a sensitivity of 70 to 89% and the specificity of almost 86% and high negative predictive value for diagnosing small vessel disease. It's very important to follow up the PI in a patient you suspect to have small vessel disease. We used to do that in systemic fat embolization and in the cases of TTB. Elevated PI measured by TCD correlate well with a variety of MRI manifestation of small vessel disease, including periventricular hyperintensity, deep white matter hyperintensity, lacunar disease, and pontine hyperintensity. Case 6, An 18-year-old male patient was admitted to ER because of head trauma. Gallus coma scale was 7 over 15. Patient was intubated and connected to mechanical ventilation. We used to do in the RR, TCD in all head trauma to know about the prognosis with the help of VI and the end diastolic velocity. This is the CT of the patient. There's contusions, there's bleed here, subarachnoid, and some midbrain here. You see here, subdural, small subdural, there is brain edema. We did optic nerve sheath diameter, it's okay. TCD was urgently done, and it revealed BI 1.31 in the right middle cerebral artery. Velocity of BI measurement has prognostic value for secondary neurological deterioration in patients with mild to moderate traumatic brain injury, with the best threshold of diastolic velocity of 25 cm per second and the BI of more than 1.25. There is very good correlation between cerebral perfusion pressure above 60 mm mercury and BI in head trauma patient. If you find BI below 0.8 in the trauma patient, there is a 90% chance that cerebral perfusion pressure more than 60 mm mercury, which is good news. If the BI is less than 1, there is 85% chance that cerebral perfusion pressure is more than 60. If it's above 2.2, there is only 50% chance that cerebral perfusion pressure is below 60 mm mercury. And if you find BI more than 3, it's very bad news, because you will get 80% chance that cerebral perfusion pressure less than 60 mm mercury, which is so bad news. So in head trauma patient, do transcranial Doppler, looking for BI to know about the prognosis and to get a clue about the cerebral perfusion pressure, which is very important in managing this patient. Back to our patient. Alarming, BI of the middle cerebral artery, basal artery are above 1.25, so putting the patient at high risk category. Repeating TCD after 1 hour, it dropped significantly. Now, right cerebral artery, it is 1 point plus, it's very important. BI, it's very important. BI is not dependent on the angle. Whatever your angle, the BI is stable, because it is a relation between the systole and diastole, and your angle will affect the systole and the diastole in the same way. And as you see here, basal artery decrease the BI. What happened? Within 1 hour, the BI dropped significantly from above 1.25 to below 1.25. What's going on? What's going on is very important to know the circumstances around the change in the BI. Number one, you need to know about the cerebral perfusion pressure, which is the related to the mean arterial pressure. And the most important thing, you need to know if there is hypocarbia or not, because hypocarbia has a very important role in increasing the BI by causing vasoconstriction of the cerebral vessels. In this patient, as you see here, it was 1.3 middle cerebral artery, dropped to 1. It was 1.45, dropped to 1. And only the clue is the respiratory alkalosis. BH 7.53. This patient, when connected to mechanical ventilation, getting they give him large 2 minute ventilation, which make hypocarbia 28 and respiratory alkalosis, which lead to vasoconstriction of the cerebral vessels and increasing the BI. And after adjusting the ventilator and dropping the pH and increasing the carbon dioxide, the BI drop back to normal. So the lesson here, BI is very important in managing the patient of the head trauma, but please take care of respiratory alkalosis before going to measure the BI. Last case, a 27-year-old male patient was admitted to our ICU due to severe head trauma and severe brain edema. Patient was flat. All brain stem reflexes were absent, according to his neurosurgeon. Relatives were informed that the patient is brain dead. We did the ultrasound here, as you see, it's the right side. the posterior, this is the anterior, this is the middle cerebral artery and the anterior cerebral artery. It's very good flow. As you see here, this flow, this spectral Doppler, transcranial Doppler, I didn't store in the machine, but I get the photo by my mobile because I need to forward this photo to the neurosurgeon consultant to not inform the patient about the brain death. As you see here, there is very good flow of the anterior and middle cerebral artery. I get this photo by my mobile and forward on WhatsApp to the consultant neurosurgeon to not inform the family about the brain death, because really the patient has good cerebral blood flow, but he was flat really. Aggressive osmotherapy was giving, patient regained cough reflex. 2 days later, as you see here, this is the right internal carotid. Here you see no diastolic flow, there is systolic spikes, only systolic spikes, no diastolic flow. As you see here, reverberating better, but no diastolic flow in the big vessels. As you see here, systolic spikes in the patient. This is a picture of the brain death. Here, reversed flow. All these a picture of systolic diastolic separation. As you see here, all these signs of brain death, systolic spikes. Sonographic pattern of cerebral circulatory arrest. The following sonographic pattern constitute a cerebral circulatory arrest. 1, systolic spikes pattern without diastolic flow, reverberating flow pattern, brief systolic forward flow and diastolic reverse flow, diastolic systolic separation pattern, systolic forward spike flow and diastolic flow with separation, no flow pattern. And you can very easily diagnose the brain death. And now TCD is highly accurate and ancillary test for brain death confirmation with a sensitivity and specificity of 90% to 98%, respectively. Moreover, the area under the care was estimated to be 0.96, underscoring the very satisfactory diagnostic yield of TCD for diagnosed cerebral circulatory arrest. This was the American Journal of Neuroradiology, October 215. Also, Academy, American Academy of Neurology, says the same talk. Thank you.